In this figure, let's look at the proximal convoluted tubule and the massive transport that takes place there. In the upper right, we have our nephron leading into our collecting duct. And what we're going to do is blow up a picture showing the cells of the proximal convoluted tubule here in yellow, surrounded by a peritubular capillary. Now recall that massive filtration just occurred prior to the proximal convoluted tubule at the glomerular capillaries. Many of the substances, including most of the water, needs to be reabsorbed from that filtrate. And so our proximal convoluted tubule is the first site in the nephron available for this massive reabsorption. This is going to occur in a logical stepwise progression, but it's important to recognize that all of these actions do take place simultaneously. Now, first step is down here at number one, and that's the sodium-potassium pump. That is found in the basolateral membranes of all of our nephron cells, and it is going to drive the reabsorption of sodium, our primary extracellular fluid cation. It would then be taken up into the peritubular capillaries. Now, in addition to reabsorbing sodium, it's also going to generate this sodium gradient, a potential energy source to drive the movement of other solutes. Secondarily, we're going to have to get that sodium into these cells, right? We're pumping it out of the cytoplasm with the sodium-potassium pump, but we need to allow it to enter the cell at the apical membranes here. We're going to allow that to occur across channels, but there are also other scenarios of secondary active transport where we might be using sodium to import glucose or other nutrients into this cell to aid their reabsorption. Now we've fully reabsorbed sodium into the interstitial space and then up into the peritubular capillary. What this does is it leaves a net negative charge to that tubular fluid. And so we're going to get charge repulsion of those anions driving their reabsorption. And that's going to be largely chloride and bicarbonate, but there will be others. They can pass across our somewhat leaky tight junctions in the paracellular spaces here, as well as possibly through the cells transcellularly utilizing membrane transport proteins on the apical and then basolateral membranes. In step four, we're going to start to reabsorb water. We're reabsorbing water because we're removing the solute, making the interstitial fluid here more concentrated and driving that osmotic reabsorption of water. Again, both paracellularly across those somewhat leaky tight junctions and through the cells transcellularly utilizing water channels known as aquaporins. And again, we would need aquaporins on both ends of the cell here, at the apical and the basolateral side. Now we're driving the water reabsorption. We've reabsorbed sodium and many anions, but what happens then is that with the water reabsorption, we start to concentrate the remaining solutes, right? Everything that is left behind becomes more concentrated as that water is reabsorbed. So we have step five here. Step five is the reabsorption of pretty much everything else. That's going to include potassium and even waste products like urea and a variety of other ions like calcium. And so those are going to be driven into the interstitium. Now, the reabsorption of urea sounds odd, but we'll get to that a little bit later. And remember, partial reabsorption due to the massive size of filtration still means we might be effectively removing that waste product from the body fairly effectively. Now, in a final step, step six, we have to take up all of these solutes from the interstitium into this peritubular capillary. That could occur by diffusion if the gradient favors it, but recall that our peritubular capillaries are experiencing bulk flux that is reabsorption only. They are dominated by a high plasma oncotic pressure. The blood proteins are tending to draw water and small solutes inward, and so we are reabsorbing everything that we've pulled out of our proximal convoluted tubule into the peritubular capillary and off into the systemic bloodstream. Now recall, we can have some forms of secretion in the proximal convoluted tubule and other areas. That would be driving things in the opposite direction, into the nephron, enhancing their excretion. And of course, we could again use the sodium gradient to drive things like protons or organic wastes into that tubular fluid.